So Henry James, The Art of Fiction, while talking about The Portrait of a Lady, will also refer to his literary criticism and as reflected in his The Art of Fiction. Now, the very opening line of this essay, it's a response, right? What is The Art of Fiction? It's responding to who?
Mr. Walter
Besson. Okay, and Walter Besson makes certain comments about writing fiction and how to judge a work of fiction, how the what the form should be like. So that's the basic premise of it. He says, and the very opening line is, only a short time ago it might have been supposed that the English novel was not what the French call discutable. Now, what is discutable? Discutable, discussable, okay, not arguable or debatable. In other words, it cannot be theorized. That's the idea, that English novel just doesn't have the kind of substance in it which can be put to theory, where theory can be applied. That is the basic idea. Now, European novels, yes, you can, that is the whole thing. So, why this so called inferior state or status of the English novel? Does it give any reasons?
He said it starts with how art earlier was considered evil,
true
in ancient times. And
well, look at the second line, literature should be either instructive or amusing, that is didactic. You know what is didactic? Preachy, teaching something, sending a message, or amusing. So that's the work, that's the job. Generally it was felt that that's the role of literature, and therefore when something instructs or amuses, instructs or amuses, that what does it mean? It cannot be, it has to be taken at its face value. There are no hidden embedded meanings to it. There cannot be any theory. Okay, so this is what this is the position that the English novel held till Henry James came along. Okay, so literature need not have any theories, particularly the literature written in the English language. Therefore, we are talking about the English novel. He is not making any distinction between American novel and the so-called novels published in the Great Britain. He is not talking about English novel written in the English language. That's what. Okay. And then in many minds an impression that these artistic preoccupations, the search for form, contributed to neither end, interfere indeed with both. They are too frivolous to be edifying. Okay, so novel as a genre is a frivolous genre, and that's what most people believe in. Even today, people who are not into these things, what are you doing? You know, many fathers or mothers may be reprimanding their daughters. What are you doing all day long? Reading a novel, or watching a movie? Can there be? Can we explain to them, people who really are not into this, that novels and cinema can also have theory? Is it possible to, is there any worth to literature? That's a basic question. Is there any worth to novel? Okay, is there any value to these things, cinema? Most people are even today dismissive of it, right? What is this cinema? What are you waste time, right? That's the general notion attached to these things. That's Henry James says that it's, that's not the case. Okay, literature and particularly novel can also be theorized and can be theorized well. So that's what he means basically by the art of fiction. Does it echo anything else? This idea of responding to a critic. Yeah. Say
introduction.
He talks about how it's not, people criticize literature as just being make believe or just a story and cannot possibly compete with real life, and his argument is that it is historical, it is like, it doesn't necessarily have to be, you know, factual, but the author's job is as important as a historian, because he's a novelist is capturing the spirit of the age and all.
Right, so spirit of the age is important, okay, and therefore he talks about how literature can have a definite form or can have a definite theories attached to it, because it is also a very, and then he gives a variety of reasons. I am asking you, is there any critic that you can feel being referred to here? Gayatri, go back to your literary criticism, this kind of debate over form of literature, where have you seen it before?
No,
the responding to something, nature of literature and poetry, and then responding to it. Well, Plato said that poetry should be banished.
Yeah.
Have you read that?
Yeah.
Have you ever been exposed to Plato? So there was this Greek philosopher Plato, and his argument was that poets are all liars, and they just pretend to represent the real world in their works, that actually they are just useless and worthless creatures. And his conclusion is that poets should be banished from the ideal republic, and all this is contained in Plato's The Republic. He wrote a book called The Republic. This is on art of running a civil society and Greek politics, you remember that. And then Aristotle responded to it. Actually, this thing echoes that. So you are saying something about a work of art or literature, and there is another response. Philip Sidney also does it. Okay, Philip Sidney also responds to someone called Steve
Gosson.
Steve Gosson. Okay, because who has recently written a work called The Abuse of Poetry, right? And that's Philip Sidney's response, an apology for poetry. You remember all these things? Okay, at least you should remember. So this is defending literature and novel as a work of art in the same vein. So this also is a, what I'm trying to say, this is not just some random guy writing against the art of novel and some other Henry James responding to it. This is an established tradition, literally debating a work of art. Okay, let me take you to this. The ending of a novel is, do you get that? The ending of a novel is for many persons like that of a good dinner, a course of dessert and ices. And the artist in fiction is regarded as a sort of meddlesome doctor who forbids agreeable aftertaste. What does this mean? You know, he is talking about a novel ought to be good, but they would interpret this term in a fashion of their own, which indeed would vary considerably from one critic to another. One would say that being good means representing virtuous and aspiring characters. And here once again we come to Henry James's favorite theme, characters. Yeah. And he always talks about characters. Many people find his novels long and meandering, okay, but then he is not really interested in plot, and he calls them his all characters are like his children, okay, and he has to do something with them, but he allows them to do whatever they want to do. Okay, so therefore this kind of, you know, interest in character. So it's not definitely it's not that he is interested in portraying good, noble characters, noble people. Okay, he is interested in characters, but not necessarily in good people. That characters have to be always good people, virtuous people. Only then there is worth of novel. Otherwise, all novels are bad, immoral. You remember Plato saying, calling poetry immoral. Yeah, so it fosters immorality in society. That's not the case. That's what he says. And again, look at it, aspiring character placed in prominent position. Another would say that it depends for a happy ending on a distribution at the last of prizes. And look at the interesting way, pensions, husbands, wives, babies, millions, appended paragraphs and cheerful remarks. What does this mean? Happy ending. The notion of happy ending. Happy ending, subscribe to some kind of poetic justice. What is it? Yeah, Rukma?
The good are rewarded.
With what?
Happiness.
With happiness.
Happiness, yeah, of what kind? And he gives you a list of lists of happinesses. Okay, and lists of happinesses could be the right husband, the right wife, okay, pensions, endowments, inheritances, legal battles won, and millions and babies and prizes and whatnot. So these are the so-called happy endings. Jane Austen is a classic example, happy ending, you know, you get a husband along with his millions and babies also, okay, so that's a happy ending. And this is what he means, that this is not, this he doesn't subscribe to this notion of happy ending. Now how does, I'm giving you the spoiler here, how does the novel end here in our particular novel? Yes, Sona. I have never seen any Henry James novel ending on this typical happy note, getting the husband you want, getting the wife you want, getting the millions you want. So far I haven't come across any such thing. Yeah, Dickens, yes, Thackeray, yes, Jane Austen, yes, several contemporary writers also, but never Henry James. That is his worldview. So how does the novel end? Sona, have you read that? Reach that point? Okay. Who does she marry? Now we are at Florence. Gilbert Osmond. We have been talking about this for a long time. So from where we ended last time, you know, she has refused all her suitors, Caspar Goodwood, Lord Warburton. She had this long debate with her cousin Ralph Touchett about the appropriacy of her refusal, and now 6 months have lapsed and she is in Florence. Okay. So the house imagery now, we should be talking about the house imagery. Go to chapter 22. Chapter 22, the opening lines. Pragya, have you been reading the novel? Yeah. On one of the first days of May, some 6 months after old Mr. Touchett's death, a small group that might have been described by a painter as composing well was gathered in one of the many rooms of an ancient villa, crowning an olive-muffled hill outside of the Roman gate of Florence. The villa was a long, now long villa, isn't it a rather unusual description or adjective, long villa, okay, anyway, was a rather long, rather blank looking structure. Do you think he's dropping clues about the place? Well, okay, blank looking structure, with the far projecting roof which Tuscany loves and which on the hills that encircle Florence, when considered from a distance, makes so harmonious a rectangle with the straight, dark, definite cypresses that usually rise in groups of three or four beside it. The house had a front upon a little grassy, empty, rural piazza which occupied a part of the hilltop, and this front, pierced with a few windows in irregular relations and furnished with a stone bench lengthily adjusted to the base of the structure and useful as a lounging place to one or two persons wearing more or less of that air of undervalued merit which in Italy, for some reason or other, always gracefully invests anyone who confidently assumes a perfectly passive attitude. This antique, solid, weather-worn, yet imposing front had a somewhat incommunicative character. And this house, this villa belongs to Gilbert Osmond. Okay. So, what clues are we given about this? See, it's not just about the villa he is describing. It's very clear. But places and spaces and cities have a life of their own in Henry James, in the works of many writers. So, what attributes are coming forward now? Yes, Pragya.
Incommunicative.
Read on. It was the mask, not the face of the house. Now, a house has a face. And this, if you go by that analogy, that a house has a face, okay, this face had a mask on it. Now, what kind of an analogy is this? The person who lives in this house wears a mask. Yes, the person who lives in the house is uncommunicative. Okay, he wears a mask. It had heavy lids, but no eyes. Now, what kind of a face does this appear to be? A face with a mask, heavy lidded, enigmatic, right? But when we see heavy lids, okay, and no eyes, just look at the, deceptive nature. Eyes are what? Mirror to the soul? Yes. So, here, when you feel that this person is just shutting his eyes off, this place just is so heavy lidded, so enigmatic, full of intrigue, enigma, mystery. Okay. Is it a place that you can trust? Not really. Okay. So that's the clues that he is throwing your way. The house in reality looked another way. Okay, it's like turning away your face. The house looks another way. It's wearing a mask, it is heavy lidded, and it turns its head in some other direction. It's looking other way. Looked off behind into splendid openness and the range of the afternoon light, in that quarter the villa overhung the slope of its hill and the long valley of the Arno hazy with Italian color. It had a narrow garden in the manner of a terrace, productive chiefly of tangles of wild roses and other old stone benches. Mossy and sun-warm, the parapet of the terrace was just the height to lean upon, and beneath it the ground declined into the vagueness of olive crops and vineyards. It is not, however, with the outside of the place that we are concerned. On this bright morning of ripened spring, its tenants had reason to prefer the shady side of the wall. The windows of the ground floor, as you saw them from the piazza, were in their noble proportions, extremely architectural, but their function seemed less to offer communication with the world than to defy the world to look in. Okay, so this is the house that Gilbert Osmond lives in. He actually turns his face away from the world. And if you have read even somewhat, this is what, chapter 22, so I am just assuming that you have read this. All this. So, what happens now? Who is the host here? Okay, go to page 2, skip a couple of pages here. The door opened with a vaulted antechamber as high as a chapel and paved with red tiles, and into this antechamber a lady had just been admitted by a servant, a lad in shabby livery, who was now ushering her toward the apartment in which our friends were grouped. The gentleman at the door, after dropping his exclamation, remained silent. In silence too, the lady advanced. He gave her no further audible greeting and offered her no hand, but stood aside to let her pass into the saloon. As she at the threshold, she hesitated. "Is there anyone?" she asked. "Someone you may see." Now, this gentleman we have not yet been introduced to, but this is Gilbert Osmond. Who is this lady? Not Isabel. If she is meeting him for the first time, how can she just boldly walk into the villa and ask him, "Is there anyone in?" Who could it be? Of course, it has got to be Madame Merle. The next few lines tell you that. Okay. "Someone you may see." She went in and found herself confronted with the two nuns and their pupil, who was coming forward between them with a hand in the arm of each. At the sight of the new visitor, they all paused, and the lady, who had also stopped, stood looking at them. The young girl gave a little soft cry. "Ah, Madame Merle." And Madame Merle walks into, so the enigmatic Madame Merle, she walks into this setting. Okay, and this, there is a little girl, we have been talking about this girl, Pensy, who her father often refers to as his Pearl. Okay, now who was Pearl? Literary Pearl. I mean, I am not asking what is Pearl, I am asking who was Pearl. Famous literary character. You remember I told you once while introducing Henry James that Henry James had written the biography of Hawthorne, Nathaniel Hawthorne, who is the author of The Scarlet Letter. In The Scarlet Letter, the heroine Hester Prynne commits adultery. The result of the adultery is a daughter called Pearl. Okay? And here, so we often talk about literature and its intertextuality. Yeah, so no one is going to say that. Now, I am often asked this question, what is intertextuality? This is a very prime, this is a prime example of intertextuality. Two writers, now Henry James and Nathaniel Hawthorne, he was extremely influenced by the writings of Hawthorne. He went to the extent of writing a biography of his, and in this novel, he calls this little girl his Pearl. He is not naming her Pearl, her name is Pensy. Okay. Does Pensy as a flower has any kind of connotation?
It's a very, I think it's a very ordinary flower that's grown.
When do you offer Pensy? When do we use, I mean, roses have a definite connotation. You are watching The Age of Innocence, right? Where you have flowers of all kinds there, and in the opening scene I told you, look at the way a rosebud is blooming. Okay, so flowers, so see, every image has a kind of, some kind of a suggestiveness or suggestion in it. So here also names have some kind of relevance in it. So when you have Pensy, it's not for no, for nothing that she is called Pensy. A very meek kind of a flower. So there's a
Oliver Wilde. Oscar.
Oliver Wilde.
Sorry. Oscar Wilde. I think I don't know if he uses the word fancy, but like usually.
Dandy. That's dandy.
There's a connotation of homosexuality.
Yeah, like no, when you are pregnant, it's an insult.
But I'm very sure that that's not the reference or allusion here. Okay, so homosexuality has got nothing to do with this Pansy. Yeah, Pansy actually means, you know, weakling. Yeah. Very feminine, extremely weak. Okay, nothing extraordinary about it. It's not like this girl before she commits suicide, Hamlet's Ophelia. Okay, She gives pensies to people, remember, before she, when she goes raving lunatic, and she goes around giving flowers to everyone around in the court, and here are a few pensies for you, it's like mourning. Yeah, she gives it to Gertrude, the queen mother. So pensy has all kinds of connotations here. It's definitely not for its beauty or some raving beauty, it's not a rose. When you want to name your daughter, you want to have a suggestion of beauty, extraordinary beauty, you call her lily or rose. Pensy is ordinary, meek, submissive. So this is the kind of father you have. Okay, you have a father who calls his daughter his pearl, which is Henry James' homage to Hawthorne, of course. And then he names her Pensy. He lives in a villa which is very dreary. It's like, how does he describe it? It's a open into a vaulted antechamber as high as a chapel, paved with red tiles, dark alleys, okay, not too well lit, not too bright, quite depressing. And here she is introduced to, she has already been introduced to Gilbert Osmond. Have we been given that kind of a reference? Because once, when they first meet each other in the novel, not before the novel happened, but when they first meet each other, is there anyone, she asked. That means they have known each other for quite a long time. Okay. Is Henry James giving you some clues here about them? Anu, any comment here? What could be the relationship between Henry James and, you have seen the reason that I did Edith Wharton's Age of Innocence with you today, how men and women who are in formal situations, formal social situations, how they greet each other. How do they greet each other? Extremely formally. Okay, so, I think you made a point that she extends her hand to be kissed, or they shake hands, or they, you know, there is a way of getting introduced to each other. Okay, he bows down to his fiancée also, that's at one point. Okay. So that's a formal social situation. Here, do you think there is any touch of formality? She just walks in and asks, is there anyone here? What kind of, what does it tell you? She is familiar with the surroundings. And this is a woman who doesn't have any male escort. She is a free agent. Okay, she travels in and out of Europe and America and all over the place. Okay. See, when we talk about travelers in Henry James and Edith Wharton, they traveled only two continents, Europe and America. That's it. So and they would call themselves extremely well traveled and well exposed people, but that's where it ended and began, Europe and America, and that was pretty well a traveled person for according to the standards of those times. So we have to bear all these things in mind. Okay, so Madame Merle, the visitor had been slightly startled, but her manner the next instant was none the less gracious. Yes, it's Madame Merle. Come to welcome you home. And she held out two hands to the girl, who immediately came up to her, presenting her forehead to be kissed. Madame Merle saluted this portion of her charming little person and then stood smiling at the two nuns. So the child has been brought up by nuns, okay? Not by two nuns. These two nuns have come to have escorted the child to, and who is not really a child, okay, she is a little, you know, an adolescent, a teenager. So Gilbert Osmond has a teenage daughter, and she is brought here, presented to Madame Merle. It looks like all of them here know each other. Okay. The idea is that Gilbert Osmond should be married off to Isabel Archer, yeah. But why should she marry, if you have read the novel that far, you know that they end up getting married, okay. So that's the act two of the novel. So act one is she is refusing, she has been traveling from America to US to England, and then she meets these men, she refuses, she turns them down, she turns down proposals by very eligible bachelors. Act 2 is when she arrives in Florence. Yeah. She's the one who. And what does Isabel have by now? To answer your question.
Money.
What have we been talking about all this while? To the two important things. Money and marriage. He doesn't have anyone. Look at his, just disintegrating villa that he is occupying. And the very fact that Henry James tells us that the caretaker of this house is dressed in a shabby livery, shabby kind of a uniform, not shiny. That these are the clues that you have. So, what does it tell you about his financial state?
Earlier, Madame Merle had described him as someone who makes indolence look like an occupation.
Exactly, yeah.
Well,
so, she has described Gilbert Osmond in extremely romanticized ways, that he does nothing, and it's made very clear that he doesn't do anything. He has no profession. He is a painter, but not a brilliant painter, so he's not going to end up becoming Da Vinci just because he's living in Florence. So, don't think that he is going to sell his paintings for millions. That's not going to happen. He is not, but there is an aura about him. He is indolent, he is lazy, and he makes laziness look like a full-time profession. Yeah. Now, Isabel is intrigued. She wants him. She is the one who brings these two people together. Yeah. But why? Yeah. Now, Sona is asking a very logical question, that if a woman loves a man, Gilbert Osmond, why should she introduce the man to someone like Isabel Archer, who is younger, prettier and way wealthier? Why should she do that? Now, yesterday I have been talking about the wings of the dove, where this woman who is, there is a dying woman, the American woman, the heiress, and the lover of this particular man, she arranges the wedding of her best friend and her lover so that they can inherit the money eventually. Did I answer you? The entire idea is, it's a setup for Isabel Archer to fall into this trap. So, she is definitely presenting all the facts. Gilbert Osmond doesn't work. Yes, he has no money. Yes, he's lazy and indolent. He's bright. He's brilliant. He's a charmer, in other words. And more. He's a great father.
Yeah.
She also describes him as a great father. Okay. He is a man that people generally love talking to. And at this stage, I mean, how much has she inherited? Do you know the figures? And convert it in today's currency. What does it come to? Who is good at maths? Anu, are you good at maths? Not at all. Yeah. No, please. 70 lakhs is nothing in today's terms.
Today's terms as in?
Those days. I mean, if you convert the whole money into today's term and then apply it, so it's 70 lakhs? Those days? 7 crores. 7 crores those days? When are we talking? Almost 150 years back?
No, it's 70 lakhs. 70,000 pounds now would be 70 lakhs. 70
lakhs.
In rupees.
Okay, and even if it's 70 lakhs or 70 crore or 7 crores, just apply it to those days. It's like never ending wealth. It's like a wealth that will never end even for your couple of generations. And this is the kind of money she has inherited from Ralph Touchett. And this is the kind of money that people like Gilbert Osmond want for themselves. Okay, he doesn't do anything. He has a daughter to support. She has been in a nunnery all this while. Why in a nunnery? Well, high society people, that was one of the features of European, not Americans. Okay, this is a very typical European aristocratic way of raising their daughters, especially. The daughters are raised in nunnery, okay, so that when they come of a marriageable age, you can present, you know, the so-called debutant, they debut, they are presented at balls and all, where young men can approach them, okay, they are, in other words, they are now in the marriage market, okay. And to, what's the best way to present your daughter at the wedding market, marriage market? To project her as a chaste virgin. Yeah. And how do you prove her chastity and virginity? This is a child who has been untouched by shadows of any, by any male shadow. Yeah. She grew up in a nunnery. That's it. That is a proof of her chastity. Okay. So that's European feudal society for you. And in walks Isabel Archer, who has got nothing to do with, I mean, you can you draw parallels between her and Countess Olenska of Edith Wharton? Okay, so someone who is always questioning conventionalities and conformity, social conformities. We have been doing The Age of Innocence. Scorsese's The Age of Innocence for the film class today. So, that's the background. So, when a girl like this is introduced, so that's the whole setup. This is a man. Please.
So, if Madame Merle is setting up the trap to get hold of Isabella's money,
okay,
how is she planning to get rid of Isabel?
She won't get, she doesn't, they don't want to get rid of Isabel at all. It continues. Is Madame Merle married to Gilbert Osmond? They don't want marriage. They want money.
She'll stay his mistress.
She will, yeah. Yeah, the idea is very clear. Well, see, that's what I'm telling you. Social conventions are not at all observed when Madame Merle enters this villa. Right? He doesn't extend his hand or bow to her. He doesn't kiss her hand the way a gentleman would treat a lady. That means there is always, this is a straight clue, direct clue, that there is something already going on between a, and no lady or no gentleman of those times would meet like this. What does it tell you? That there has been an adulterous relationship going on between them. Perhaps it has been going on even when Monsieur Merle was alive. She is Madame Merle, and we are to, Ralph Touchett says very pointedly at one point that she was once married to Monsieur Merle. Okay, so Isabel asked, remember? And who was Monsieur Merle? He was Madame Merle's husband. Okay, that's his identity. And it's believed that he is dead, or maybe he isn't. Okay, who knows?
Meets Mrs. Touchett after that. Mrs. Touchett makes it a point to say, I was faithful to him.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And it's almost like unlike you. And Madame, it's the narrator explains that Madame Merle understood that that was directed at her.
Yeah.
So again, that's a pointer to
Madame Merle's many philanderings. Okay, so she is a woman like that. She doesn't need marriage, Sona. She doesn't want, so the, all these are middle class moralities happening, that you love a man and you want him all to yourself. These Nayanthara, what is the secret of this intriguing smile? Say something. I am very sure something naughty is cooking up in your little head, so let's get out of it. No? Okay, so Madame Merle is definitely not looking for a husband. She has had her share of husbands. What she wants is money. And you remember there was a point when she admits that I want, what's the use of my talents and my accomplishments and etc. when I have no money. At 45, I have to display my talents again and again. Remember? She says that. Whereas you have youth, you have beauty, you have money. Because you, in other words, you have everything. So all you need is a good husband, and you have turned down the best of men. And let's see. And that's what Ralph Touchett means, that we are all going to be spectators of your career. Okay, that's what. So you refuse Lord Warburton, and you refuse someone like Caspar Goodwood. Both these men represent something, some virtues. Caspar Goodwood has other kinds of virtues. Lord Warburton is very visibly full of virtues. Okay, and who do you choose? An adulterous male. And now again a spoiler. Who do you think is Pansy's mother? Madame Merle. Okay, so you see there is an intrigue here. This is a setup, and this is something. And what are we leading with towards now with all this information? The theme of betrayal. So you ask me, why should she do that? She's betraying her friend for money. Isabel Archer trusts this lady. Isabel Archer, who has gambling in her blood. Her father has gambled away his fortune, and suddenly she comes into this inheritance. Okay. So she anyway has gambling in her DNA, and she meets this person, and she forms all her impressions through Madame Merle, who leads her into this set. Okay. So again, we have the theme of betrayal in Henry James. One more section, and then we will call it a day. I am on chapter, the next chapter should be 23. Please look at chapter 23. She had mentioned to Isabel, she as in Madame Merle, skip a few lines. Most of the people, the girl would find it well to meet, of course, she said. Isabel would know whomever in the wide world she would, and had placed Mr. Osmond near the top of the list. Now, this lady who knows several people in Italy, she has placed Gilbert Osmond on the top of the list, who is like must meet people, must see people. Okay, she should be introduced to Gilbert Osmond, and then Gilbert Osmond, with his considerable middle-aged charms, he will take over. Why does Isabel choose him? Again, psychological realism. She is nudging. She is doing that very well. But then she is nudged towards Lord Warburton, and she is nudged towards Caspar Goodwood by Henrietta. So why this?
She met Madame Merle. She kind of has this fascination with these pretentious manners and all that which Osmond has, and he's a charmer too. So kind of. She gets that from Madame Merle, I think. She gets so fascinated with the way she behaves.
Madame Merle is like a mentor.
Yes.
Like a mentor.
Yeah. And because of that, she kind of saw some of those manners of Madame Merle in the hospital also.
He was an old friend of her own. She had known him these dozen years. He was one of the cleverest and most agreeable men, well, in Europe, simply. He was altogether above the respectable average, quite another affair. He wasn't a professional charmer, far from it, and the effect he produced depended a good deal on the state of his nerves and his spirits. When not in the right mood, he could fall as low as anyone, saved only by his looking at such ass rather like a demoralized prince in exile. So this is how he's described. He is a prince in exile. What a romantic figure. But if he cared or was interested or rightly challenged, and rightly challenged by the right sort of woman. Okay, so this is a man who needs challenges. Now, all this makes him very attractive in Isabel's. Caspar Goodwood needs no challenges. Okay, he has his life chalked out very well. Okay, Lord Warburton, is extremely open. Okay, he doesn't, he is not a challenge at all. This man is a challenge. Okay, what sort of a man could he be? Then felt his cleverness and his distinction. Those qualities didn't depend in him, as in so many people, on his not committing or exposing himself. He had his perversities, which indeed Isabel would find to be the case which all the men really worth knowing, and didn't cause his light to shine equally for all persons. Madame Merle, however, thought she could undertake that for Isabel. He would be brilliant. He was easily bored, too easily, and dull people always put him out. But a quick and cultivated girl like Isabel would give him a stimulus which was too absent from his life. In other words, if a woman like Isabel comes into his life, he would change for the better. There would be, yeah, this, there is nothing this that this man can't accomplish. But with that, but he gets bored too easily, yeah, and he needs the right woman. And do you think Isabel takes the bait? Perhaps she is. So there is a touch of vanity in her, yeah. Lord Warburton too easy, Caspar Goodwood too prosaic, not in romantic enough. Okay, but this man so supremely romantic, a prince in exile, bored easily, and to keep him interested and stimulated will keep her on her toes. So she likes challenges, and that's the reason.